places that are familiar to me are the ones from Nuria. So you may know this story, but I've thought I, for those that have not been involved in Nuruagat, I'll give you a brief introduction what Nuruagat is about, and then we'll have three presentations by one of the PIs, David Grundy, one of the early stage researchers, Annika Polster, one of our external advisors, Jack Wood, on how they look at the project that we've done over the last 4 years. To start with, this is a training network. This is not a research project. And that makes quite a difference because this is basically developing a program for training PhD students to become PhDs. So this is not a research project. This is a Marie Curie measure. That is, to my knowledge, to the best of my knowledge, the first one that was started in gastroenterology, not to speak of neurogastroenterology, and that ran from January 2014 to next January when we finished after 4 years. It had a total volume, financing volume of 3.67 million euros. It trained 11 PhD students, early stage researchers, for 3 years, and two postdocs for each of them for 2 years. All were enrolled in formal local PhD programs. In addition, we provided additional measures for all of them. So summer schools, mini MBAs, soft skills training, a lot of other things. One of them was happening here in Cork just before this meeting. They were actually trained by a group of people from elementary health on issues that are related to working with industry and in industry. This had a long story that can be told on one page, but it is a long story. It was a call in the Seventh Framework program that I kind of approached in 2009, started working on it, submitted it in December 2009. It got rejected with a score of 84 out of 100 points, didn't pass evaluation. We did a redress that was not passed, was not accepted, so we were left with the decision, do we do another time? We did another submission. Basically, this was all a decision that I had to take because that was work that was predominantly performed in. So I used the entire project and we changed a bit and resubmitted it and got a score of 86.2, still not passing. So we were left with the question, do we do a third time? We did a third time. And again, ended up with 8.8 points, so not passing the threshold. And at that point, I was willing to give up, and some people convinced me we should do another trial. We were so close and had so minor corrections to do that we thought it could be worth doing it, and I resubmitted it, and we ended up this time with 93.2, actually. In between these number two, number three, and number four, we did not change the project. We did not change the project, which tells you that at this point, the evaluators changed and had a different view on the topic. And that's something you have to keep in mind. Whenever it's evaluation, changing the evaluator may as well improve your scores than changing the submission. We were with 93.2, we were at the cut edge. So we were on the waiting list. We were not approved right away. We had to wait half a year before we finally got into the step of negotiation and contracted and started then in January. The project started in February. Actually, February 14th was our 21 was our kickoff meeting, and from then on we did for 4 years. So that is now terminating. This is the consortium. So these are the centers across Europe, from Sweden, UK down to, this is meant to be Israel. We had 9 academic centers and two. Initially, we had two. Now we had three. Commercial centers, commercial companies involved in that didn't work out quite well for two of them, but that's not an issue that I want to address now. What I wanted to show you is to do that, the projects that were done in the individual centers were not necessarily related to each other. So they can be quite independent, in fact. There was no requirement for collaboration between the projects. The requirement was that the training the subjects received, the individuals received, should be somehow related. So I came up with a model that linked the different labs together. In fact, the labs were chosen because I knew they would cover these aspects, and they designed a kind of a scheme that would link them all, and that would go from nutrition over inflammation, pain, and enteric processes to symptom generation and to central processing. And this digestive cycle gave the framework how these projects were interrelated, and each of these were covered by projects, as you can see here. They were actually in different segments. So there were three different work packages where they linked together, and the green ones were the plant industrial projects. So each of the work packages had one of these industrial projects attached to it. And the work packages then were related to central processing, physiological and immunological processing, some genetics, and finally gastrointestinal symptoms and symptom generation, and then some industry aspects to it. And to show you what we did is we'll start with this work package. This is actually work package 2, where people were dealing with basic science projects with physiological, immunological, and genetic aspects. The people behind this did do the projects. I'm not going through any of these projects because that doesn't make sense in the framework of what we have here. Some of the projects were probably touched upon by the other speakers, but epithelial barrier function and microinflammation was one of the projects where Lionel Bueno was the initial PI that passed away, unfortunately, and just Jasper was the PhD student. We had luminal bacterial products, mucosal immunology, where Vincenzo and Roberto did and TK was the student. Mucosal ENS signaling in chronic disease, these were topics that were formulated 5 years ago. So in fact, there were some changes in the topics because you cannot ignore, if you do science, you cannot ignore what happened in between. However, Brussels insisted on the topic. So we never touched the topics because that is something essential if you actually deal with Brussels bureaucracy. We had Michael Schemann working on mucosal missing the name. Inflammation and pain by Dave Grundy and Frederike, and then the evaluation of serotonin, which was an industry project but never worked out because that was never actually taken over by the industry. That was assigned to it, but David and Michael did do the job with Natasha. The third work package is actually this one that deals with clinical aspects of motility, transit, secretion, and sensitivity. Here we have neuroimmune interactions and post-infectious visceral power syndrome, where Guy Brookstein and Eloisa did the work. We had dysfunction of esophagus with Andres Smout and Thomas Herregotts. We had evaluation of intestinal motility by intraluminal imaging analysis, which was an industry project that did not really fully succeed. Tanya Novak and Michael Drostal. And finally, this was the gastrointestinal motility and secretion story that also changed some of the content with Fernando Aspiros and Teodora Kribik that did with the study. And finally, the central part where my projects are located with central mechanisms and processing of visceral sensation, where we had pathophysiological alterations and symptom patterns in functional bowel disorders with Magnus Simran and Annika Polster, who will present a little bit later. Autonomic nervous system and visceral hypersensitivity with Kazim and Ahmed that did do the study. Central representation of visceral signals, that was my project, and I worked with Insun Lee here, and I had another project in there that was modulation of central processing by modulating the gut microbiome, where I worked with Huying Wang. And finally, this was another research project that driven by industry, Nazar Mazurak did do the work with Kurt Zimmermann. So this is the whole range of projects that cover this cycle, all projects being quite independently in terms of what the individual PhD student did, however, related to each other, and that created a kind of a training network that probably profited both the interaction between the PIs as well as the interaction between the students, beyond the fact that they had common measures. So with that said, I would have asked for this presentation, I've asked a PI, David Grundy, to kind of review from a PI perspective NeuroGut without giving him the task to review all the projects. So he may kind of focus on a project. Annika Polster to do that the same with a view of an early stage researcher. She was the first one actually coming into the project as PhD, the first one, then also leaving, and finally our external advisor Jack Wood for having a look at the project from an external point of view. If that is what I have to say, then if there's no question, then we would just move on, and I would ask David to present here what his view of NeuroGut was. Thank you.